around the room, there's three of them in there, and I said, you know, including the guy I'm talking to, who's a very high up in the Department of Government Security, and...
Hold on, let me back up. He said, hold on a second. He said, so, you start over. You did what with your mouth? And he said, do something that's rude?
Well, you know, he said, my mouth fell open with absolute shock at the fact that he'd simply denied the fact that I'd seen this guy that had been following me, realizing he's a policeman. My mouth fell open with shock. He says, you're sitting there with your mouth open, that's rude. And I just looked at him and I said, it's rude to lie to me. And I said, this is the craziest situation I've been in, this is crazy. And he goes, for me, it's not crazy, for you, it's crazy. And I swear to God, it was like being in a horrific dystopian movie, except it was happening to me. And I was just...
It sounds like The Prisoner, when number six, you know, they had all those phony trials doing the same crazy stuff. But see, all those movies in 1984 and all that are based on real stuff.
Yeah. And, you know, when I was leaving, I realized at that point that was it. The fact I'd seen that guy, I knew now what happened. I was being followed by a quite large number of the state police. And I don't know what that had cost. I don't know what cost they've thrown at this operation.
Well, you know why. I mean, normally in there, they just make sure the heroin comes in to make sure the school kids get it. And I'm not joking. They mainly run prostitution and drugs in Greece. Very corrupt. And they're running the drugs into Europe. And also a lot of sex slavery law, kidnap kids. Those guys don't do a lot of work. They mainly kidnap children and deal heroin. And I'm serious when I say that. And so, you know, to them it was a big joke. They were there. The big heroin dealers sent them out. That's what Bilderberg does, launder the money. And, you know, big super bosses are in town that their bosses work for. And so to them it was a big joke to terrorize a British slave who thought he was free. It was a big joke to them. They were just thinking about shipments of kids and things they had to deal with. Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I can't put thoughts like that in their heads.
Oh, really? You didn't know they're in child slavery rings? Oh, yeah, the Greeks are, yeah.
I don't know. But what I do know is that they lied to me, and they lied to me persistently and all the way up to the top. And they lied even when they knew they were lying. It was just one big lie. And when I left, I talked to one of the younger ones that escorted me out of the building at this point, because I thought, well, that's it. I'm not getting any more out of this. I know now what happened. And I was escorted out of the building, and... on the way down the stairs, I looked at the guy and I said, listen, you know that when you tell a lie, tell a lie like that, it makes you less of a person. And do you know, to his credit, he looked ashamed, because I just felt at that point like I had nothing else to cling on to except the truth about the situation, the truth that these lies were being told.
But see, Charlie, to them, they have the force. They have the power and the guns, so they say that makes their lie real.
Yeah.
That's like Austin cops when I was in front of the Dine Corps building and I said, you know, they run giant child kidnapping rings, congressional hearings, and the Austin cops laughed and said, well, yeah, big deal. We, you know, I do work in there. So to them, it was like by making it a joke, it didn't exist. Now, I was a real guy telling them something real, but see, they weren't involved in child kidnapping. But by making a joke about it, you see, they become accomplices. See, it's all real funny till it happens to their kid. Or till they're sitting there dying of cancer when they're 45 because they took the shots. Then it won't be funny.
But you know what? What I have to take away from it, though, is a few important things, which is, I was stopped and searched so much and told to show my papers so much. Like, I mean, you know, it was horrific, the amount of time that I was having to just show who I was, give my father's name, how long was I staying there. I've become rapidly anti-ID cards. And by extension, microchipping, because that's this game over. When that happens, it's game over. It really is. I can see that now, and I didn't know that before, and I know that now because I've lived in a weird little kind of reality show police state for the last week. And you know, I'm not kidding. I'm not joking. I did, and it was horrific. And I was scared for my, you know, I was scared for my safety. I jumped into a random cab at one point and sped to the British Embassy, which happened to be closed. It was a Saturday. Well, you don't want to arrive at the embassy scared out of your life and be told, the embassy is closed. That's their words you don't want to hear. Anyway, but, you know, these things were happening to me, and you know, and Bilderberg was happening at the same time, and no one was there, the press wasn't there, you know, and I was being chased around at Athens metro station, and, you know, it was quite crazy and quite surreal, but the surrealist thing of all is that where was the media? Where were the newspapers? And how much did it all cost? And why were there private security companies, security officers detaining me? And why was the Greek Navy deployed? And two F-16s and where was CNN? You know, the whole thing is just this crazy bubble of questions that people...
Because if CNN admits Bilderberg exists, that then legitimizes everything we've done. But instead, by them still denying it exists, that's just discredited them. But they're still in this delusional world where they're going, no, the emperor is wearing the finest clothes. And we're going, no, he's butt naked. And they're like, but we have SWAT teams. And we go, that still won't put food in our bellies. You know, and they're like, but we have SWAT teams. And we go, yeah, but we have the truth. And they're like, but we, you know, we have bird flu we can scare you with. So I've got callers, Peter in Iraq, many others, with inside reports on the Department of the Army telling veterans they've got to secretly register their guns, even in their own private homes. That is coming up. But finishing up with you, Mr. Skelton from the London Guardian, and we'll have you back up in the future, you know, probably with Jim Tucker later in the week if you can do it for, you know, with both of you, because Jim's just gotten back. We're giving him time to rest and then have him on. Because, you know, this does chart the future of the world. We've proven they really are calling the shots for most of the planet. Bilderberg, and of course, so it's not newsworthy and the media won't touch it because it's so important. How did this end? I mean, how did it go after you left the police station? What happened when you went to the airport? Just briefly, anything else?
Well, I was, do you know what, I had that fear in the pit of my stomach that that suddenly, from being stonewalled and being let out, I'd actually suddenly uncovered something. So I was scared again. I was suddenly scared because I'd seen the guy, and then I'd been lied to, and I thought, oh, God, I don't know what's going to happen now. I know that sounds crazy, but it doesn't, oh, I'm saying it again, there you go. So I got to, as fast as I could, to an internet cafe, and I got on the phone to my wife. I dictated what had happened. I sent copy to the Guardian as soon as I could, because you know when you know something and you know something's happened, you have to share it instantly because then the information's out there. So I did what I could to get it. Sounds like an overreaction, but I wasn't overreacting because I'd been chased around Athens and been grappling.
You've been arrested twice. So quit saying that. That's part of the programming. Just quit making excuses for yourself. What else happened?
Well, I sent it off, and you know, I just sat there absolutely shell shocked, and I came home, you know, and I've just been sitting here like a vegetable. I went, yeah, just, you know, I'm absolutely exhausted by the whole thing, and but I've also determined to go back again next year and to get people to be, you know, to bring their cameras.
Why is the Guardian? Yeah, go back next year. Why is the Guardian running a photo of you from your comedian work wearing a clown mask? I mean, I guess the Guardian can only report on this if they put you in a clown mask on the cover. What is that about?
With respect, that's me. I went to the National Museum of Greece, and that's a copy of an ancient theater mask. And it's my little way of saying that I was involved in a kind of theater, a theater of the absurd. So that was my little joke. And I think it is a theater. I accidentally got a peek behind the curtain.
All theater. They're kidnapping kids, running drugs right behind the curtain. They're running the whores. They're pushing the Prozac, the Ritalin, the vaccines. They're eugenicists above them. And it's all a theater for all the little cows, all the little slaves to never figure out that right behind the curtain there's a slaughterhouse, a meat grinder going 24/7. Charlie Skelton, stay in contact as things develop. If you'll come back on, I'll have you on with Tucker. We appreciate you, buddy. Take care. We're glad you got back in one piece, and we appreciate your courage.
Thanks, Alex. Speak to you soon.
You bet. Take care. Okay. Peter just hung up from Iraq. I knew I had to go quickly. Peter in Iraq, call right back in. See, that's why I needed to get Skelton off so I could go to Peter in Iraq. I said I wanted Tribbs to call about, are they being told to register their guns? Are they being told they got to tell the government what guns they have back at home? 1-800-259-9231. One line open. Peter, call back. 1-800-259-9231. Callers, I want to get Peter or others back online, so hurry when I go to you. Joe in California, do you have inside knowledge on this being more widespread than just at Fort Campbell, Kentucky?
Yes, hello, Alex.
Yes, go ahead, Joe.
Hey, sorry. Hi, Alex. My name's Joe. I'm from California, and I was formerly a unit armor at Fort Campbell, Kentucky. I'm not sure if you know. I'm sure most of your leaders know the hierarchy in the Army. And not that I want to take away from this, but I think it should be viewed in its proper perspective. One, military members are basically non-citizens. They've given up their rights under the Bill of Rights, and they've basically gone under admiralty law or martial law. And by being
let me stop you. That's not. Let me stop you. Let me stop you. That's not entirely true, and I do know. I do know. They can't make troops take experimental vaccines. They can't order troops to rape children. They can't order troops to march in and be nerve gas in a test, which they've done. So, I mean, to tell somebody, we want to know at your private home or off base what guns you own. I mean, you're really saying that they don't have any rights.
If I have a car that I use to drive and in that state has an insurance law, the commander can have a safe.